Okay, so the last time we continued our study of Java programming language. We said that in Java we have a very similar for loop mechanism. It's called enhanced for statement. It is very similar to C++. Range for statement. All it takes is just a parameter and an array name. And here is an example. Here's an example. We have an array, and last time we said that this is the only situation where we create an object without using the new operator. That this is the only exception. Initialization of the arrays and initialization of the string objects. Other than that, you have to use new for creating new objects. And I have array here, and this is the parameter. And it is, as I said, it is very similar to what we did in C++. This one is especially useful for the Java programming language because, as we know, Java is an interpreted language. The Java virtual machine runs the bytecode, the compiled Java code. So it's a software, piece of software. If the Java virtual machine knows that this is a loop that will start from the beginning of the array and it is going to continue until the end, it can produce very efficient code. Okay, it would be as efficient as C code. So if it is suitable for your case, always try to use these kind of structures that does the job directly for you, okay? Otherwise, it has to be compiled and it has to be optimized separately. So give more information to the compiler so the compiler can behave more intelligently. That's what we did last time. So it takes the total and it prints the total. Okay, then we continue. We said that in Java, everything is the most of the sources, most of the textbooks, online resources, they say that Java has two mechanisms. One is pass by value, one is pass by reference. This is not exactly true. Everything is pass by value in Java. It is exactly same as in C. In C, everything is pass by value. We copy everything when we send the functions. We copy everything. We take copies of things, including the pointers. But if you take a copy of a pointer, and if you do something through that pointer, you may simulate call by reference by using the pointers in C. In Java, it is the same. Since I have, let's say this one, okay? This name here is a reference. This is an integer, okay? This is just a fundamental type object, fundamental type variable. This is a reference. If I send this to a method, I am sending a copy of it. If I am sending this integer to a method, I am sending a copy of it. There is no other way in Java. It is different from C++. As you remember from C++, we had two ways of sending things. One is call by value, the other one is call by reference. But in Java, we only have call by value or pass by value. We achieve this simulated call by reference through these references. That's what we said last time. Okay, so I think we have stopped here and yesterday, and we are continuing from this point on. You have any questions from what we have covered so far for the Java programming language? Any questions? Okay, where is my attendance? Did you sign the attendance? You are signing it, okay. So let me continue then. I don't like this silence, but I don't know what I should do. Variable length argument list. I mean, without talking much, let me show you an example. If you say this, okay, if you say this, I need average is a method that takes doubles, but I don't know how many doubles it takes, okay? I don't know how many doubles it takes. And this is the way how you call it, okay? I may call this average with two doubles or three doubles or four doubles or five tuples, whatever. So it's a, as the topic says, title says, the variable length methods. So the length of the length of the parameters, it depends on how you call it, this average, and you write your header this way. You will say that I expect a number of doubles, double dot dot dot, and the numbers, and I have this total zero. And numbers is an array actually here in this case. Numbers is an array, so I iterate on the numbers array one by one, and at the end I divide this total by numbers length. So a number is a regular array of doubles. This is how you achieve variable length methods in Java. Remember, we had the same thing with the C programming language using the macros. There was a way of doing it with the macros in C programming language. Printf is written that way. In Java, it is done this way. It is not used that much, but it is there, so I like to just show you. Yes?
We initialized the double numbers as a array before, or?
No. This is just, numbers is a parameter for this method, okay? Is a parameter for this method, and it is created automatically for you when you make this method call, okay? If you call this method with a single double, an array of size 1 is created, and it is passed to you. If you call average with no parameters, an array of size is created for you, and it is passed to you, okay? So as you see, it has to be all the same type. It has all have to be doubles. But remember this, where is my printf? Printf is a Java method too, but printf can take as many parameters as it likes, and the types of parameters could be different too. So it is possible to write methods like printf in Java. It used to be possible with the C++, and it is possible with the Java too. But I don't remember how to write methods like printf in Java. There should be a way, I don't know. Okay, so I mean, printf and this average are similar in that we don't know how many parameters they take, okay? It is decided when you make the function call. But with this way, all the parameter types has to be the same. With the printf, it depends on what you are using in this percent sign, right? So in this case, I am using a float. And it could have been percent S, it could have been percent D, right? So printf is a more general way of defining variable length parameter methods. But I am not going to go into that detail. Java is a very large language, actually. I mean, the compilers might be simple, but it's a very large language. And to learn all the details of Java is as detailed as learning all the details of C++. Somebody asked me a question the other day. They checked out the templates details from the Java standards, I guess. We didn't talk much about the templates, actually. I mean, we said that they are simple, the idea is simple. But there are many, many, many details. I mean, maybe I try to talk about it a little bit by using this default parameters for the templates or the constant template parameters, etc. But we are not talking, as we said, we are not trying to cover everything in this class for the C++ language or the Java language because we have only a limited amount of time. And most of the time, the things that we are going to talk about are just techniques. They have nothing to do much with the object-oriented programming languages. Yes?
Is the number of parameters decided on runtime or compile time?
Of course, in compile time, because when I make this method call at line 29, I know that there are two parameters, and I will create an array of doubles of size 2. So I know it.
So it doesn't matter if we create the array ourselves and make the call with an array, or if you use the number.
Sure. Yeah. Well, if you like to do it, yeah. But this is much more convenient, right? I mean, this is much more convenient. Otherwise, you have to say that I have an array and put the elements one by one in it, and sometimes you have to create objects to put that in an array, etc. Yes.
This printf is everything in Java is derived from object class, right? So the printf can have some number of parameters of type object, and it can somehow know that the first parameter is string, right? So in that string, the other parameter types is available. So it can convert the other parameters of type object to other types and print as well. So it is possible to write printf with your current knowledge.
Well, yeah, well, you could do that, sure, of course. I mean, if printf takes all object parameters, yes, but I mean, during the compile time, printf is smart enough to give you error messages saying that I am expecting a string, but you are passing me a something else. Okay, so I don't know, do I have it? Maybe I can just check it. And these kind of things you should check, but okay, so this is print line. Let me convert this to printf. And let's say welcome and percent insert switch to the other keyboard. Yeah, let's say I like to print a float, but I am sending, let's say, another. What did I do? This is Turkish. Okay, let me go to Turkish keyboard. I know where this thing is. Okay, I'm sending a string. Let's try to compile this one. I'm obviously making an error because this is float and string. I am expecting that I will get a compile time error. No, it did not. So what happens if I run it? So it's a runtime error. It is implemented exactly the same way Erdoğan just said. See, it says that I cannot convert illegal format conversion exception. I cannot convert string to something else. So it is trying to convert that string to something else.
Public floating point numbers.
Yeah. Probably it is some kind of a compiler switch that says you check these kind of stuff during the runtime. Okay, as these are the things that are, I mean, kind of details, but important details. Just to understand how this thing works, just go to, I mean, how the printf is implemented in Java, read the documentation, and try to implement similar stuff. I don't want to go into these kind of details, but if you go there and if you try to learn it, it would be very useful. And try to compare it with how printf is implemented in C, okay? In C, we definitely use macros. And in Java, it looks like this one is taking, so it looks like this printf takes object reference. So printf is implemented, maybe the printf is implemented this way. Instead of double, there is this what? Object. Okay. Object dot dot dot and many things in there. But in this case, I don't know how they would achieve this. Okay, you read it yourself. I mean, there are a few problems in there, but you will figure it out yourself. The other thing is command line arguments. The command line arguments are handled. See how I run my Java program? I said that run this. Okay, Java welcome. If I like to pass my command line arguments, let's say I like to pass 1 and ASD as a command line arguments, two arguments to this Java program, then I need to handle this command line arguments. This is how it works. This is, let me get rid of, maybe not that one, but maybe get rid of this part. Okay, so I say that my main method takes an array of strings from the Java virtual machine. Array of strings, if the length of the array is not 3, then I print an error message. Okay, then I print an error message. It says that I need 3 parameters. It will be an array size, initial value, and increment. Let me show you the program output first, and later we will see the program itself. If I run my program this way, Java init array, it prints an error message. If I run it this way, Java init array 504, it starts from 0. Okay, it starts from 0. There are 5 elements in the array. Okay, there are 5 elements in the array. It will start from 0, and you will fill in the array by incrementing the filled in value by 4. So it is 0, 4, 8, 12, and 16. And if I do this, I have 10 elements in my array. You will start from 1 and increment is 2. So you understand what's happening. It is filling in an array and it is printing out the results. And this is what I do. I say that if my argument length is not 3, if you did not give me 3 things in the command line, I am printing out an error message. Okay? If you gave me 3 things, then I will do this. Since the things are passed as strings, I need them as integers. This is how you do A to I in Java. Okay? There is a class named integer. That's a very strange name, actually. There is a class named integer, and it corresponds to a kind of this int class. For integers, for ints, there are integers. For doubles, there are double class. And for characters, there is a character class. These are classes, these are not types, okay? These are real classes. And we call this in Java boxing. For all the primitive types, there is a corresponding boxed class. For integers, it is integer. Okay, for double, it is double. For character, it is character. For boolean, it is with a capital letter. And let me show you where they are. I think it is, they are defined in Java lang package. Remember, Java lang package is automatically imported. You don't have to import it. And inside Java lang, we had another class that we use so frequently, the string class. Okay. Where is it? Okay. Oracle site is good. And inside this Java lang, see, this boolean, character, what else, double, float, integer, long, they all correspond to the fundamental types. And remember what we said, each fundamental type is they are different from the objects. But if you like to use your fundamental type like a class object thing, then instead of using the integer, you int, you use this integer. Okay, let's see what it says inside it. So this class is smart, and these are the fields in it, and this is the constructor. See the constructor? Okay. It takes an integer value if you like to build it, or it may take a string too. Okay, if you provide a string to the constructor of this integer class, it takes it, and later you may say that, okay, you may say that, where is my int value? Okay, If you are an integer object, give me your int value. It returns an int, not integer, but int. Okay. So this is kind of the standard behavior for all the boxed, okay, for all the boxed types. An integer is a box type, and all of these classes they have these static methods. Parse integer, okay. You give a string, and it parses the integer in it, and it returns an integer to you. So parse int is an is a static. Where is my parse int? Yeah, okay. It takes the a string and it returns an integer to you if it can. Okay. And if I go to there, I don't know what happened. Yeah. If the string doesn't contain a parsable integer, it throws an exception, number format exception. In Java, this is how you specify the exceptions that you are throwing from a method. Remember, we had the same thing in C++. And when you say it throws a number format exception, it means that it is possible to get an exception from this one. Let's go to the code. The code says that, okay, parse this integer, A to I, okay? Give me the array length, and now I make a new array, okay? It's an array of integers. Since array of integers, each element of the array is an integer, I then have to use the new operator to make new int variables. And I do the same thing for the second and the third argument of the passed values, okay? Not the difference from C. In C, the length of the arguments is the length of the arguments includes the name of the executable program too, right? If I am writing the same program in C, I had to use number 4 in here, right? Because I had to count the name of the program too. In Java, you don't have it, okay? In Java, you already know the name of the program. What is the name of the program? Name of the program is same as the class name, right? Because when I run this, remember, when I run this, I had to run it this way: Java init array, and these are the parameters. So these only these three things are passed to the main method. In C, this one is passed too. Okay, the name of the program is passed too. Okay.
May I ask you a question about these box types? Can I create a box type instead of this integer array length and create new array in next line with the box type integer?
Sure. Yes. Yeah. I mean, the question is can I have a declaration like this? Of course.
No, I'm not talking about that. That's a type. That's a class, so you can do it. Class type array, right?
Yeah.
I'm asking about the instead of that 10, can you use a box type integer?
This boxing and unboxing. Okay, this boxing and unboxing is done automatically in Java, and most of the time, whenever you need an int, okay, whenever you need an int in a place, you could use this objects of type integer, okay, objects of integer. So they can be used interchangeably. So the boxing and unboxing is done automatically most of the time. So whenever you need an integer, you could use an whenever you need an int, you could use an integer, or just the opposite. Whenever you need an integer, you could use an int. Okay? But just don't depend on it too much. And we don't like too much mixed type of expressions. Do the right thing. Use the right type. Because this is a fundamental type. this is a class type, reference type, they are different. Of course, when you do this, what do I need now? I need to write a for loop, and I need to create 10 integer objects, right? This is a reference now. This is not an integer int anymore, okay? This is a reference. So in a for loop, I need to create 10 integer objects using the nib operator, okay? It is different from this type of nice array. It's a now, it's an array of references now. ARR is an array of references. This array is an array of integers. This ARR is an array of references. Reference of integer. Okay. By the way, the values of some people ask me this. Let's say I have a method M1. It takes an integer I. Whatever I do inside this method will change the value of I because it's called by value. Some people ask me if I like to change the value of my parameter. It's kind of call by reference for this one. Can I do this? Integer, okay, I, and change the value of the integer contained within this object and return from M1. The answer is yeah, you could in theory, but all of these classes, all of these box classes are immutable. You cannot change their values. Okay, this integer, this long, this integer, this float, double, they are all immutable. You cannot change their value. Once they are created, they stay that way. There is no way to change their values. Okay? There is no way to change their values. Okay, so once I said that, let's move on. I have now three numbers, length of the array, the initial value, and the increment. And in a for loop, from 0 to array length, counter plus plus, array counter is assigned this value, initial value plus increment times counter, and then I have this format statement that you know from C, okay, two strings, okay, I say that I am going to print two strings, one is, will take space of 8, so that it is nicely formatted, and then I print them one by one, okay, using this format again. That's the whole program, okay? So we used, again, we used this command line arguments, and we get to talk about the boxed integer class and the boxed typed, fundamental typed classes, okay? And they are all, as I said, they are all defined in this Java lang package. And inside this Java lang package, there are other nice stuff too. What else? Did you? Okay, we had the string, right? Yeah, string is there. Okay. String, the difference between the string and string buffer and string builder, remember, string is an immutable class, okay? Once you make a new string, you cannot change their value. But string buffer is a mutable. So you can change the string buffers. If you need to change a string, then you use string buffer. Okay. Good. We will talk about the system later and you guess what thread is. Okay, we will talk about those later. Any questions? Question? Yours is not a question. I don't count yours as questions. I need questions. Because you are asking too many questions. Okay, if I don't have another choice, then I will let you ask questions.
Why do we have to change once we create it? You said immutable, right?
Yeah.
Why is there a need for us to change that once we created it?
Well, I mean, wouldn't that be nice to have a string in C++? Remember when we say string A, B, C, and later we change our mind because we are human beings. We do this. Don't you want to do this?
Well, it's not convenient.
What do you mean convenient?
It is convenient. It is, it gives you some more power.
Well, I mean, well, I mean, remember this, remember this, remember this strcat. What does a strcat do? You, it catenates two strings together, right? Don't you want to do that? You add some more string at the end of another string. Mm-hmm. So strcat is not possible with regular Java class string. This operator is not there. You cannot say s plus assignment A, B, C. You cannot change it. So what do you do? You do the, you do this. Okay? You do this. S plus. So what does this mean? Make a new S. So this plus operator returns a new string, and that new string is assigned to this reference again. The old string is discarded. Okay, so this is inefficient. If you do this, you are creating a new string. Okay, you are doing the catenation thing first, and you are creating another string, and you are assigning to this one, and old one is discarded. If you don't want to do that, then use string buffer. String buffer can do that kind of stuff. So what is the problem with string buffers? The problem with string buffers, remember our gradebook class? We said that since string is not mutable, then we don't have that problem. String buffers has that problem, and we are going to talk about it later in a few minutes. Okay? Any other questions? Let me move on then. Overloaded constructors, of course, overloading is allowed, and it is encouraged in C++ and Java. And as in C++ 11, your constructors can call each other. And this is how you do it in Java. Let's say I have a class named time, or time2 in this case. I am going to represent the time by its hour, minute, and second. And I will have a few constructors. Let me show you the constructor that does the... Yeah. This is a constructor that takes hour, minute, and second. It calls directly the setTime method, and setTime is calling this individual setHour, setMinute, and setSecond. It is written nicely, but if I like to use the no parameter constructor, then I write it this way. Okay, no parameter constructor doesn't take any parameters, but it makes a call to the three parameter constructor that takes three integers. And this is how you do it. This, and inside the parentheses, these are the parameters. In C++, what was notation? It used to be, this is the C++ notation. Time to 0, 0, 0, right? So we don't do it this way in Java. In Java, we don't do it this way. We do it this way. So this method call, okay, this has the same meaning as in C++. This method call has to be the first executable statement in a constructor's body. Okay? It has to be the first statement in a constructor's body. Before that statement, you cannot have any other statements. So before doing anything else, like we did in C++, okay, make your constructor call first. Okay? This was done automatically in C++ because I placed my constructor call in the initialization section, and Java achieves this because in Java you don't have this. You don't have this notation. There is no initialization section in Java. In Java, you say that your first executable statement should be this method call. And after that, if you like to do other things, then you can do. And this is a single parameter constructor. It calls again this three parameter constructor as the first statement, two parameter constructor, and then this is the constructor that we keep calling. And this is like a copy constructor, but as we said before, we don't have copy constructors in Java. There is no such thing as copy constructor. There are just constructors, overloaded constructors. If you like to make copies of your constructors, If you like to make copies of your objects, then you use the clone method of the object class. And we will talk about it. Okay? We'll talk about it later. So I think just to, this is just to tell you that how, this is how you do the stuff. But copy constructors in Java are not as critical as, well, I mean, as I said, there are no copy constructors, but they are not as critical as in C++, because most of the time you don't need the copy constructor. It is not needed much. Why? Because in Java, you cannot pass objects by value, right? You cannot pass objects by value. Why? Because you cannot touch to your objects. You can only keep reference to the objects. You cannot take an object in your hand and send it to a method. All you can do is you have a reference to an object and send that reference to a method, which is done by call by value. But call by value with objects is not possible. So your methods will not make automatically new objects. Also, any assignment like this one, A assign B. With the assignment, there is no copying. I mean, copying of maybe the fundamental type content, integer to integer, double to double, or reference to reference, but there is no object copying using the assignment operator. Assignment operator cannot copy objects, okay? So that's why you don't have the overloaded assignment operator in Java, okay? So assignment operator is very simple. It either copies fundamental type contents or the references, pointer copying, okay? So there are no critical assignment operator overloads, or there are no critical copy constructors. And we talked about the destructors actually. We don't have destructors in Java. Instead of destructors, we have finalize methods, which are similar to destructors, but they are a little bit different, and we'll talk about them. Okay? So this one is just given just to show you that how the if you like to make a copy constructor, this is how you do it. But this kind of constructors are very rarely needed. We don't write these kind of constructors. Set time with all the other stuff are the trivial to write, so I didn't include them in these slides. Okay, good. So we are talking about the overloaded constructors, and this is how you do them. Okay, let's talk about this finalize method. As we said before, finalize is called when the object is dying. When the object dies, finalize is called, but you don't decide when the object dies, okay? The garbage collector makes that decision. And garbage collector is very efficient. It doesn't kill objects unless it needs memory, okay? Remember this one, okay? Remember what we said? Let's say I have a money object created this way, new money, $10.20. I did some stuff with money. I don't know what I did. And at the end, I did this. M gets the value of null. In that case, nobody holds a reference to this money object. Its reference count is zero. I expect that it will die. Okay? The garbage collector may say that, okay, I know that. That object is not going to be used by anybody. I know that. But I don't need that memory used by the money. Okay? Instead of spending CPU time to get rid of that object, I will behave efficiently, and I will hold on until memory is needed. So most of the time, your finalize methods will not be run as you expect them at the time. Okay? So garbage collector has on its logic, has on its intelligence, and it may decide to. It never kill anybody that has a reference count greater than zero, okay? It doesn't make any mistakes, but it is up to the garbage collector to make that dying decision, kill that object decision. And most of the time, we don't want to control that behavior. But if you like to control it, if you like to force the garbage collector, ask the garbage collector to say, run and clean the memory, yes, you could do that. But usually we don't prefer it that way. So we let the garbage collector do its own job. Okay, so let's write a finalize method. As we said, finalize method is called when the object dies, and it is called automatically by the garbage collector. And we don't know when it is going to happen, unless we are forcing the garbage collector to kill all the zero reference count objects. Okay, let's see an example. Here is an example, employee, a familiar class. Okay, I have first name, last name, and it looks like we are going to count employees using a static data member, and it is initialized inside the class. Nice. Okay, so initially it is not, its value is zero. So every time I make a new employee in the constructor, I will increment the count by one. So this will count the number of employees. Okay, so the employee will take two parameters, first and second, last name and the last name, first name and the last name. And I will make these assignments. Again, what are these assignments? These are reference assignment, pointer assignments. There is no string copying, okay? Remember the problem that I talked about? I said that if I make a new, okay, yeah, I think it is there, yeah. If I have the string name ABC, string last name is DEF, and I am making a new employee object using name and last name, my employee object, then after I have created this object, if I like to change the sixth character of this name to K, I can't do that. Why? Because I can't do that. Why? Because this is not possible. Strings are not mutable. Okay? You cannot change a string. That's why they made the string immutable. Okay? Remember, maybe if like, it is not implemented that way, but if you like, if you could think it this way, strings, okay, there is a string class and there is a string buffer class. Okay, this one is derived from that one. String buffer behaves exactly the same as string, but it has extra features, extra methods that lets you modify stuff. That lets you modify elements inside the string, okay? That's what we do. Well, it is not implemented that way, but we can think it like this way. Okay, so let's look at the constructor. Very simple constructor. Reference assignments. Increment the count by one. Printf statement. %s%d. And string and a integer. Okay, so that completes my constructor. Every time I call this constructor, this count will be incremented by one. Remember, we don't have copy constructors, so we are not concerned about incrementing this value when we make a copy of our object, right? Because there is no making a copy of object the way that we think in C++. So incrementing this count in the constructor, if we have a single constructor, is good enough. Okay, and this is our finalize method. Finalize is protected. Oh, that means that nobody can call it. Okay, that means that nobody can call it other than the privileged callers. So my customers won't be able to call finalize, but we don't call our destructors ourselves anyway. So this is good. Finalize is protected, and it is not going to be called by my customers. And when the finalize is called, count will be decremented by one, and I will say that I am killing this employee, and my count is this. Getters, and I don't think that we have the setters. Yeah. We don't have this address. See, this is a static. So the method get count could be used with the class name. That's why we call these kind of methods class methods. And this is a class instance. Okay, this is a class variable. These are instance variable. Okay, let's see a simple driver code, employee test, in a different file, employee test. Okay, I have nothing to do with the command line arguments. At the beginning of the program, I just call employees before instantiation, %d, and I call my static method, employee.getCount. Okay, this is my name of the class, and this is the getCount method, employee.getCount. Of course, I expect that this will print zero. Why? Because I did not create anything yet. Okay. Line 13. This will call the constructor with these two strings. Remember, the constructor is say that make this assignment, and increment the count by one and print out all that information. So this will print Susan Baker, and the employee count will be one. And this will say my employee is Bob Blue, and employee count will be two, because I am incrementing the same class variable count. Okay? So this will print 0, this will print 1, and this will print 2. And then I do what? And I call getCount, even though it's a static method. I can call getCount through this reference E1 and do the same thing with E2. We don't like these kind of static method calls in C++ or in Java, because if method is a static method, then let's call it this way, okay? And I know that this will print what? This will print? How many? This will print, what is the integer to be printed? This will print E1.getCount? Two, of course, two. Why? Because getCount returns the static data, remember? Static field, which is shared by between these two objects. Okay, so this will print two, and this will print two, and this one will print two again. Okay, so each of them will say I am printing two. Okay, and another one. Let's print the information about the employees. Employee one, get first name, last name. It will print all of those. And then I do this. E1 gets the value of null, and E2 gets the value of null. That means that those two objects created by these two new operators, their reference count will be zero. Their reference count will be zero. But I don't know if the garbage collector is called. To force the garbage collector to run, okay, I am asking the garbage collector to run now. That's what I do. Remember the system class, which was defined in Java package? It has a static method called GC, garbage collector. I am asking the system to run the garbage collector for me. Okay, this runs, and this will kill all the objects that has a reference count of zero. Okay, so after line 34, I know that two finalize methods of the employee class will be called. Okay, line 34 and two finalize methods will be called. So the line 34 calls it. How about this one? If I write printf employee.getCount here, what would I get? I am trying to make this call, line 21. I am saying that on line 33, I am trying to print out employee.getCount. What would I get? Two. Sometimes two, sometimes one, sometimes zero, because I don't know how the garbage collector behaves. Garbage collector just can kick in after I make this assignment and run the finalize of employee one, and garbage collector can kick in after I do this assignment. We don't know when the garbage collector will come in. If the memory is needed, then as soon as I make this assignment, garbage collector can run the finalize method. I don't know. That's why I didn't put anything in here. I said that system.gc. I know that definitely after this one, finalize methods will be called. And after that, I am asking the count of the employee class again, get count. This will definitely will print. This will definitely will print zero on the screen. Okay. So let's look at the sample output. This one comes from where? This zero comes from, I think this zero comes from line 10, right? Line 10 will print that zero. 13 and 14 will print the employee information. So this is line 10, and this is 13 and 14, right? So the count was zero, then one and two. And then after the employee instantiation, remember e1.count, get count, and e2 get count, they are all twos. They are accessing the same static data member. And the this is the information about the things. And these two come from the finalize method. These two come from the finalize method after the GC. So GC has run somewhere here. Okay. And finally, this line 40 is this one. Okay, so this is a little bit, the idea was it is similar. Whatever you have created has to die, okay? Everything is created and initialized with a constructor, it is the same. For the destructors, we don't have destructors in Java, but we have finalize methods. And the behavior of finalize method is a little bit different than what we have in C++. That's all we are trying to say with these slides. Okay? Yes?
Can we default parameters of a constructor like we did in C++?
No, there are no default parameters in Java. Default arguments, no. That's why you need to write lots of constructors, overloaded constructors. Yes?
And why do we use a counter, solid counter, since garbage collector's behavior is random? We can't be sure if...
Well, it is not perfect. It is not all random. We know that if... I mean, it doesn't randomly delete objects. It just deletes them if their object count, reference count is zero. Okay? So it is not random. But you should know about it. I mean, if you like to count the number of employees that you have created so far, it's good, right? I mean, how many employees do I have alive? You would know that.
But I'm not sure again, since garbage collector may delete it some, or maybe holding it again.
Why would you like to know how many employees do you have in the memory?
Well,
I mean, what is the reason? The reason is maybe for memory management and that kind of stuff, right? Yeah, I mean, it is still useful. I mean, we don't use the static data members just to count stuff. There are many other useful things. Okay, so if you like your garbage collector to do the garbage collection every time there is a zero count, then I think it is configurable. I am not sure, but I think there is a Java garbage collector. Where is my okay, basics. I think there is a option that says don't delay garbage collection somewhere. Can I write it? Java garbage collector, don't delay. Delaying garbage collector cost. Delaying is a better thing because you don't want to run because if you have the memory, if you're not going to use the memory, why are you deleting them? I mean, just keep them in memory. That will be much more efficient. Okay? garbage collector delays Java with no. Sometimes I have this. Yeah. Sometimes garbage collector kicks in and does lots of garbage collecting, and that delays my program. I couldn't find it. I think there is an option that says that don't delay your garbage collector. But people try to, they don't want to delay it. Okay, they don't want to. They say that I like my garbage collector to be run at this position. Before that, don't run it, because that's going to, if I'm in a critical loop, a retie system or a game programmer, then you may prefer delaying it, or you may prefer don't delay it, just run it at this point. I don't have anything to do. I am out of time. I will take this question and let's take some break. Yes.
Wouldn't delaying the garbage collector be bad, like if we have, let's say, 500 objects that are still in the memory and the garbage collector kicks in suddenly and we have 500 objects to delete, so
yeah,
it causes a mass flag.
Yeah, that's most of the questions are like that, right? How can I avoid garbage collector delays in Java? Garbage collector causes massive lags. So they are asking the same thing, yeah. I mean, you like to either in C++, you don't have any choice. As soon as your object is out of scope, it is dead. It is garbage collected by you, okay? But in Java, it is more flexible. You may delay it, or you may say that, okay, how much memory do I have? This much. So I have enough memory. I can keep making new objects without deleting them. Now I am not in a time critical phase of my program. Run the garbage collector now. Okay? This is more flexible. Okay? But you have to think about it. You have to design your program accordingly. Okay? Good. Okay, let's take 10 minutes of break. Where is my attendance? My attendance sheet? Did everybody sign it? Did everybody? Who didn't sign it? İkinci ders vereyim bunu bir daha. What?
Is set ordered or not?
I didn't say anything about it. I don't know.
It's normally ordered, that's my rule. It's normally ordered, the one implementing
the STR. I didn't specify if it is ordered or not, so that's your design decision.
It's a short pointer. Can we use normal pointer in the
You cannot iterator. Use a normal pointer in your classes, but if you like to use it while you are doing stuff, you are.
So can we use it in the iterator class? No.
Sure, yeah, but don't make them your data members. You could use them, but don't make them your data members.
Can you use a container class as well?
Container class?
Like you implemented
in
one.
The STR class?
Yes.
No. No. Yeah. That's what it is in the homework.
Eski videolarda bakalım hocam.
Niye?
Eski videolara bakalım. Assignment operatörü neden kanslıyorsun?
Unutuyorum ya.
Kanslı referans sanmıyorum.
Rekoru aynı şey.
Temporary bir yer. Yani tek farklı operatör şey operatörü var.
Sen bir kere şey olmuyor.
Ben şey de order.
Yok kanslı referans önündeyim ben birkaç yerde. Ama bazıları öyle işlemet etmiyorlar. Normal referans ürünü yazıyor. Nasıl başlayınca vereceğim ya.
Şeyde de mesela artı prefix veya postfix operatörlerinde de temporary bir oluşumumuz var.
Hayır. Artı şeyde postfix'te öyle. Temporary object çünkü kopyayı gönderiyorsun sen.
Evet.
Constant referans yollaman lazım. Yani constant temporary bir object'i yönetmen lazım. Çünkü eski haline return etme lazım. Diğerinde öyle değil ama diğerinde kendini referans return edebilirsin.
Assignment'da da kendini const referans yapabiliyor değil mi?
Assignment'da kendine const referans yapması daha verimli.
Hocam dönerde şey eklememiz lazım galiba. C begin'le C end. Çünkü constant iterator için ayrı şeyler var ya.
Çok da değil. C++'da C begin, constant begin diye bir şey yok ki. Begin var.
Ben şey referansına baktığım zaman yani C begin, C end, R begin, R end var. Normal bir de begin ve end var. 6 tane iterator fonksiyonu var.
Ne var bir de? Ne?
R var, yani reverse var.
Normal begin dediğin zaman ona gelen şeyi sen constant iteratörle refer edebilirsin. Constant iteratörle. Constant iteratöre normal iteratör atayabilirsin. Tamam. Olur ya.
Hocam vektörün ve setin şimdi farkı ne oluyor?
Efendim?
Vektörün ve setin farkı ne oluyor şimdi?
Set denen şey küme. Küme bildiğin.
Şu an bizim eledeki tek fark şey mi? Index of fertility erişimi mi?
Hayır olur mu ya? Küme denen şey repeat etmez.
Duplication yok.
Vektör de var.
Öğretmediler mi size? Bunlara öğretmiyorlar lisede. Sana da mı öğret? Sen neredesin?
Ben Karadağlı mı hocam? Karadağlı
mı? Karadağ'da mı liseler bitti ya?
Hocam.
Hayır lisede değil ki küme. Küme yok mu da?
Niye liseye geldik?
Hayır değil lisede gidiyor.
Bir patlama olur mu? Kümede duplication olmadığında ilkokulda öğretmiyorlar zaten.
Yok bulamadım.
Ya, hocam Karadağ.
Hocam estetik patlamı.
O kadar da bitti. Estetik patlamı. Ben bulamadım.
Niye?
Estetik patlam diye bitmişsin.
Exception.
Onun exception. Estetik patlam exception var. İnternet yazdığın zaman birisi bizim üniversitelerde verdiğimiz ödevi yüklemiş. O çıkıyor zaten. Estetik patlam.
Öyle bilmiyorum ben de bilmiyorum.
Zorunda estetik patlam diyor.
Bu ihtimalle yanlış yazılmış.
Try catch var mı? Onlardan bahsediyor.
Yok. Ya throws exception diyordur ya. Ben ne diyorum?
Estetik patlam yoktu hocam.
Patlam ne ya? Bir şey ben bunu söyleyeyim. Ben yanlış yazmışım durumu.
Parametre mi olacak? Onun gibi bir şey. Prompt parametre.
Bet param, bet param bu bet.
Param ne? Tamam. O da STD, STD.
Şeyde ne ders çıkıyor?
Parametre. Ben parametre gördüm, onu görmedim.
Ben de.
Ya oğlum. Kaybol orada. Bak ben aynı şey değilim ki
oğlum. Sıratör klasörü normalde STL'de nest olarak implement edilmişti de.
Evet.
Bu evde mi nest olarak implement
onu sordum. Öyle soru istedi ama çok bir farkları yok ya. O yüzden bir tanesi fixine de entegre edebilirsin. Hani heze yapabilirsin.
Anladım. Statik mi olacak, dinamik mi olacak şimdi?
Ne?
Vektör ve şey,
kuma.
Niye statik olsun?
Dinamik nasıl yapacaksın? Shared pointer ile.
Şöyle yaparsan bir şey yapmıştı ya, partial field array yapmıştı.
Hani, tamam o normal pointer ile yapılmış.
Bu shared pointer değiştiremiyor. Shared pointer yap.
Shared pointer'ı
değiştiremiyorum.
Sen bak şöyle yapabiliyorsun ya.
Yani.
Nereye yazacağım?
Bak mesela saldırıyorum.
Şehir
yaptın ya. Şehir ihtiyaç eşittir new integer. Öncekinde şeyini mesela yedekliyorsun pointer'ı.
Zaten niye yazıyorsun? Çalışmıyor.
Çalışması gerekiyor.
Çocuk para yazdı.
Neden çalışmıyor?
Çünkü
öyle yapmışlar. Öyle bir şey yok. Assignment yok orada. Assignment'ı zaman öyle kod kodlar çağırıyor. Assignment'ı çağırmıyor. İşler gelirken assignment yazarsan assignment'ı değil ki kod kodlar çağırıyor.
Ben de
çalışmıyorum zaten. Şimdi bir bak
internet fonksiyonlarına bak. Dönmemizde de telaşlanmış. Bir de herhalde sınırda falan herhalde. Benim sınırda değil diyorum. Ödedim. Sonra Apple'ın yanına gidiyorum işte. Değiştirmek istedim. Geçen senaryo şey.
vektör setlerini set map istiyormuş. Öğrenci setlerini vektör map yapmış. Çünkü internette patlamaz şey çıkıyor. Birisi internette $30 ödevi yüklemiş. Çözümlüyor. Hoş bir açıklaması ve patlamaz. Eskiyle patlamaz.
Görse daha yanlış yapacağım. Evet, bir yetekli de.
Thank you. Ben çözüm bir tekleri yok. Al bir top. Top çay.
Arkadaki sıraları ters bölmüşüz ya. Kompetini sağa sağdakini sola bölmüşüz. İnceleri değiştirdim.
Biz koymadık ki onları. Biz sadece birazcık ileri it dedik.
İşte, ileri ittirmek zorunda kaldık bunları. Şuna göre bu ilaydı.
Okay, so we said that there are no const keywords in Java. Similar to const, there is another keyword named final. Final, in a way, it is similar to const, but it is not const. As we said, there is no const parameter passing or const method in Java. But if you like, you may make your instance variables or the data members using C++ terminology final instances. So let's see an example. Here is an example. Class increment. increment.java. I have an integer total initial value is 0 and it's like a constant integer. Final int is a private final int increment. Since it's a constant, we write using capital letters, and this, the value of this increment could be set using the constructor, but after that it cannot be changed since it's a constant. Okay. We did not initiate it yet, but we are going to initiate it once we make a new object of this increment class. Okay. Who did not sign the attendance sheet? Okay. Can you move somewhere? Okay, you will get it. Because all the people who didn't sign it. Okay, so the constructor takes an increment value from the client and makes this assignment. I can make this assignment even though it's a constant in the constructor, right? How else you're gonna change it, right? How else you're gonna assign an initial value to it? This is how you assign an initial value to a constant data member or constant field. And this add increment to total is a method that increments the value of total by this increment amount, and that's it. That's it. So this is the whole class, and I have this toString method. ToString is a special method. We inherit this method from the object class, and this method is called automatically whenever the objects of this class needs to be converted to a string. Okay. If somebody needs to convert the objects of this class increment to a string, this toString method is called automatically. What do I mean by this? You will see it in a few minutes. Okay. Because of this method, we don't have any operator overloads. Like, remember, we need the we overloaded the operator stream insertion to print out our objects to the screen. We don't do that in Java. Instead, we overload this toString method, because toString says that I am going to convert this class to a string, and it is printable right now. So the whole class is this. It starts from there and there. It's like 26 lines of code. Let's write some driver code. Increment test.java. Our main, I have a new increment object. Its increment value will be 5. Okay. And see this one, line 10. Line 10 says that I am going to, before incrementing %s, I am going to print an string. So what did I give as a string? I give a value. Value is of type increment. So this is not a string. So the compiler says that to be able to print this value, I need to convert to a string. Okay. I will call value.string. And where is it? It is here. Okay. It is defined here. If I didn't have this one, what would happen? Compiler error. If I did not define this one, what happens? There is a default toString, right? That comes from the object class, okay? What does the default toString that comes from the object class do? It prints some memory information. It says that this is of object type this one, and its memory location is and that kind of stuff. That doesn't make much sense, okay? So this always compiles whether you overloaded, whether you redefined your toString method or not. But if you did it in a nice way like this one, it will print nice information about your object. So this is how you do, instead of doing the stream insertion operator overload like in C++, this is how you do print out your objects on the screen, okay? So you produce string out of your objects. And if you don't define anything, then those are still valid. Okay, so this is what I did. And from 1 to 3, I call this method add increment to total. This will add 5 to that number, which was initially 0. It will be 5, 10, and 15. At the beginning, the total value, okay, before incrementing, the value will be 0. And after increment 1, it will be, total will be 5, then 10, then 15. So how does the toString work? Let's look at this toString. So this looks like what? In C, we used to do this kind of stuff. It looks like in C we had exactly the same thing. Line 24. It returns a string that contains total equals some number, and number comes from there. In C, we used to do this a lot using the function. No. It was exactly the same thing. Instead of format, I would write something, and as the first parameter, I would give the string name. Str, what? sprintf, str, comma, this one and that one. So string printf, okay? So this is very similar to the string printf. This is how you do it in Java. Again, string is a class defined in Java lang package, okay? And this one is a static method of that class. Format. Okay, so every time I do this, value and s toString is called. Value and s toString is called. Okay, and of course toString is a public method. Otherwise, nobody can call it. My clients cannot call it. So this is how we do the final instance variables in Java. As I said before, you cannot make, there is no const keywords in Java. You cannot put a const keyword in there, or you cannot do the same thing with the final. You cannot say final something something, or you cannot say final final method. Okay. Okay, any questions? Good, then I will continue. So you will keep your silence, but I will continue. These are all important stuff. Test them, okay? You have the slides, you have the videos, okay? Just look at the output and try to write the same thing yourself, just to familiarize yourself with the Java conventions. Okay, remember we talked about packages, that Java has lots of tens of packages, popular packages. If you count the third party software, you have hundreds of thousands of packages. But how are you going to make your own package? This is how you do it. You say that instead of at the top of the source file, you will say that I am making a new package. Okay, my package name will be this. Usually the convention is this: use your internet address to name your packages so that you don't have the same package name with some other company. Okay, so package name conflicts goes away. So this guy, I got this code from this book, Detail book. Okay, details address is detail.com. So com.detail.javahowtoprogram6.ch08. So for maybe our packages that we create in this for this class, maybe I could have said tr.edu.gtu dot maybe CSE dot to CSE 401, maybe, yeah, 421. That would be maybe my package name, okay? So even if somebody has the same package name, CSE 241, it won't be similar because it won't be the same because my internet address is different. This is just a convention. You don't have to follow it, but this is just a convention. So this guy says that I am making a class named time1. It will be very similar to what we did before, but I will put this inside a package, and the package name is this. Okay, so you write your regular classes. Okay, again, the name of the public class and the file name should be the same. Public class and the file name is same. You may have more than one class inside the same package, and some of them could be public, some of them could be private to this package. Nobody can access to it, okay? And that's how you write your private classes. And that's the whole class. I have two string, which I have inherited from object class. There is another two string, but this is a specialized one. This doesn't have any standard meaning. Two universal string. This one will print 5 a.m., 6 p.m. kind of. This one will print standard 5 a.m., 6 p.m. kind of notation. This one will print the universal notation. It will print 23:55, etc. Okay? So this is how you write it. Hour, minute, and second. This one will say AM or PM at the end. So that's the only difference between these two. Okay, you compile your Java file into a package, but for that one you would say Java compiler minus D. I am creating a new package, and what was the name of the class? Name of the class was time1.c. Okay. It was time1.java. So this will make this class into a package, and the package name is this one. To be able to use this time1 from your code, to be able to use this time one from your code, you are gonna say import, okay, com dot detail dot java how to program 6 ch08 dot what time one. Okay, it's a little bit long, but that's what you have chosen. Okay, you import it and you use it. Okay, so making packages is no problem. Java has a similar mechanism for creating Java archives or jar files. Java archive, okay, jar files. If you like, you can put all of your source code and the needed image files or the text file and etc. inside a Java archive and send that Java archive to your customer. Java archive is just one large file and it will contain your bytecodes, source codes, whatever you want, or the image files or the video files if your program needs these, and you put them inside the same archive. You know this program, Unix program named tape archive, tar? Tar is used, for example, this is for create a new archive and the name of the archive and everything. Put everything inside this name archive, okay? So this jar thing uses exactly the same command line option as the tar file. Tar utility, okay? Tape archive and jar archive are kind of compatible. This is for Java files, this is for general purpose, okay? And it uses exactly the same notation. So jar files and packages are kind of related. This is how you send your code to your customers, either using packages or jar files. So I will not, you read about them, I will not go into details of them because this has nothing to do with the object-oriented programming languages. Okay, so I think I did the same thing in here. Okay, let's talk about inheritance. In Java we have inheritance. It is very similar to C++. Only terminology is a little bit different. Let's say I have this inheritance hierarchy. At the type I have A, B and C derived from A, and D is derived from C. In Java, we don't call it derivation. We call it extension. B extends from A, okay? B extends A, C extends A, D extends C, okay? It is extension. We don't call it base class, we call it super class, okay? We don't call it derived class, we call it subclass. Okay, Java thinks classes as like sets, küme in Turkish, okay? We say that the set of objects that belongs to class A contains the set of objects that belongs to C, right? So A is a superset of C. That's how you remember it. If we think this way, let's say this is my employee, okay, and this is my salaried employee, and this is my hourly employee, okay? If you think about the objects of the employee class, this is my employee class, salaried employee and hourly employee are subsets of this employee class, right? That's how we think about it. And this is the standard object-oriented terminology that we use to talk about the inheritance hierarchy. Okay, the basic idea is the same, software reusability. We make new classes from the existing classes by inheriting everything in that class, including their data and behaviors, the data members and the functions, fields or the methods. And we add new capabilities, either by adding new methods, new data members, or modifying the old behavior, okay? So we have the subclasses and we have the superclasses. Okay, so let's see one example. I am going to use the commission employee example again. So I have the commission employee. Commission employee has first name, last name, social security number. Remember commission employee made his money? He said that if I am the commission employee, I will get some commission from all the sales that I make. So there is a commission rate, 10%, 15%, and this is the sale that I made, maybe $2,000. If I make a sale for $2,000, and if I am getting the 10%, then that means that my paid money is $200, right? Okay, so five things that I need to keep for a commission employee. Constructor is simple. First name, last name, social security, sales, and the rate. And I make all of these assignments. Assigning the strings is okay, but set gross sales and set commission rate, maybe it needs some kind of an error checking. So I'm calling my public interface setters. Set first name, no problem. Get first name, getter setters, set social security number, get social security number. Again, for the sales and the rate, I do some error checking. Sales cannot be less than zero. Rate should be between 0 and 1.0, okay? So these are the getters. What else? And I have the toString method. I need this toString method to be able to print this employee, commission employee on the screen. And this is the end of the file, commission employee too. Okay, so this is our base class, or this is our super class. Okay, this is our super class. And I will write a subclass for this one. This is how you write it. I am going to write base plus commission employee. It gets the commission from the sales. Also, he has a base salary, every weekly salary. Okay, base plus commission employee extends commission employee. Instead of saying, remember in C++ we used to say public commission employee. Instead of saying public commission employee, I would say, okay, I am defining a new class, but this class is an extension of commission employee. Okay? So that's the main syntax-wise difference between C++ and Java. Okay? Syntax-wise difference. And I said that I am observing all the features of what is available from the super class. And this is my base salary. I introduce a new field. And this is my constructor. Constructor is a little bit complicated in terms of the parameters, because base plus commission employee is a base commission employee and some more features. So this is for the first name, last name, social security, sales, and rate. And this one is new. This one is new. Okay, double salary. So this is how you send, how you make a call to the superclasses constructor. Super is a keyword in Java, new keyword in Java. Okay, this is how you call the superclasses constructor. As the first statement, like the this, remember this? Like the this keyword, you make this call as the first executable statement of your constructor. Remember in C++, we used to say commission employee constructor and my first name, last name, social security, sales, and rate. This is what we used to do, right? Now we don't do it that way. We do it this way. Okay? I call the superclasses constructor. So I handled everything about this one. Now I am handling my new features. Okay, set base salary. And this class is very simple, actually. Although it's a complicated class, since I reuse everything from the commission employee, this is what I do. Set a base salary and get base salary, then that's it. I don't need to define anything else. Maybe I should overwrite this. Okay, earnings. These are all okay. Earnings is defined. I'm going to write them again. Earnings is defined. Did I have earnings for the other one? Did I? Yeah, okay, here it is. Earnings for the commission employees, commission rate times gross sales. Okay, that's the earnings. By the way, are these private? Oh, these are protected. Okay, good. So we have exactly the same thing. Public, private, protected has exactly the same meaning. Good. And I have the public earnings. And I am now overriding earnings. Why do I say overriding? Because this function is a virtual function. This method is a virtual method, and we will see why, even though we never said anything about the virtual or not virtual. We will talk about that in a few minutes. And my earnings is the same as the superclass's earnings plus the base salary. Okay? Plus the base salary. Same as the superclass's earnings plus the base salary. Maybe instead of doing that, maybe I should do this. Super.earnings, call the super.earnings, which will return this to me, and I will add get base salary to the super.earnings. That will be my earnings. This is a better implementation. Okay. How about toString? toString is very similar to what we had with the commission employee class. It prints the first name, last name, social security, sales and rate. And it does exactly the same thing, and at the end it says base salary. Again, this kind of repeats whatever I had from the super class. Maybe here, okay. This would have been better. I should maybe do this. Return. Okay, return string dot format. Okay, percent s, and then percent s, and percent s. Okay, you tell me what should I write now. Super dot to string. That will print out everything regarding these five things. But then I should add base salary, comma, base salary. So I am just repeating these two. Okay. This is a much better code than this one. So I'm reusing whatever available from the super class. Good. Okay. So, I mean, as a new concept, I didn't say anything new. All I said was, in Java, we call it an extension, and this is how you do the extension, use the inheritance. Okay. This is how you call the superclasses constructor. Okay. And this is how you call the superclasses other methods. And this is how you override your methods. That's what I said. Inheritance is important. It's a very important concept. And on inheritance, we need to talk maybe for a week. But since you know everything from C++, I will just introduce the mechanism of doing the inheritance in Java. And that's it. By the way, in Java, this is not possible anymore. You cannot do multiple inheritance. You cannot do multiple inheritance. This D inherits from both B and C. It is not possible. That's why, remember what was the problem with the multiple inheritance? The problem was from these two paths, I am inheriting the same thing two times. That's gone. Okay. And if you see, there is this G function, G method, or G data member. And I am adding new stuff, G Fs here. And this one will inherit both G's and F's two times, and that is not good, and compiler has to deal with these kind of problems. And as a customer code writer, I need to be careful about which F I am calling. Okay. Now these kind of problems are all gone, but well, I mean the problems are gone, the advantages are gone too. Sometimes I like to behave, okay? I am an employee, but also I am a student too, okay? As an employee, I have a salary. As a student, I have a GPA. And I like to keep both of them, right? Multiple inheritance was good, but it is gone. Java has a solution for that one without running into this problem, and I will talk about it in a few minutes. Okay, any questions about inheritance in Java? Yes.
Is there a thing that we can do in Java that we cannot in C++ regarding inheritance? We just talk about the things that we cannot do. What is the one thing that we can do?
As far as I know, well, I mean, there is nothing that you could do in Java or C++ or in C sharp that you cannot do in assembly. Yeah, okay. So take that one, okay. So that the general answer to that one, maybe you should say, can I do it more conveniently in Java then? I don't know. Can you think of anything? There are some advantages, disadvantages, but usually, I mean, Java designers, they were perfect. They were very smart C++ users, okay? And the Sun Corporation was the number one. I mean, Sun was the 1980s, 1990s Google. They had the money. They had all the PhDs. They had all the top people in that company. And it was designed by smart people. They didn't make much mistakes in there, okay? So whatever they have seen as shortcomings in C++, they try to correct it in Java, okay? So we don't have any obvious, so this is a problem kind of thing. So they even realize that printf is like something good, okay? They introduce back to the language printf. C++ kind of rejected using printf. Java uses printf. Printf is good. It's our friend, okay? So I don't know. I mean, I am just trying to show, I mean, idea-wise, both languages support, this is a relationship, right? Is a relationship is there. Upcasting, downcasting, the ideas are there. The way we do them is a little bit different. It's a little bit different. Okay? Maybe I can say that, okay, question, maybe regarding that one. We had a slicing problem in C++, right? Let's say this is our hierarchy. Let's say I am writing my code in C++. C++ code. If I have an object of A and object of B, there is a relationship, so I could do this assignment, right? So there is a what? There is a slicing problem here. Do we have the slicing problem in Java? We should. Is it possible to, if I force it, is it possible to get?
No, because you don't copy.
No, the answer is no. Answer is no, because the assignment, the meaning of assignment in Java is reference copying, pointer copying. If you do the pointer copying, right, there is no slicing problem. If you call the slicing problem as a problem, it goes away, but some people say that it is a feature of the language. It's not a problem. I know what I am doing, and I want that slicing to happen. So I used to have this capability. Now in Java, I don't. I mean, even if you like, you can't do slicing in Java because there is no object assignment. You have only reference assignment. Okay? So these are the, to answer to your question, I wouldn't call it advantage, I can do it there. Some things are possible, some things are not possible. Sometimes it is fine with me, sometimes for other people, it's a problem. Okay? So, but the idea is, not everybody is a perfect, very advanced C or C++ programmer. Let's make their jobs easier. Let's get rid of these pointers. Don't worry about the memory leaks, dangling references, slicing problem, etc. So this is how you do it. So what is the cost? The cost is a little bit CPU time, more memory. Okay. If you don't let the customer touch your objects, then use references all the time. Then how am I gonna make the arrays of your objects? You won't. You will have references of arrays of references, not arrays of objects. Okay. So that will be more memory. That will be more CPU time. But that's the downside. The upside is this is easy to use. No memory leaks. Virtually no memory leaks. Okay. Good. Sure. Yeah.
You are talking about overriding and redefining interchangeably here. So
yeah.
Can you?
Something
about that.
This is overriding. This is overriding, and this is overriding. Whatever I did in these function redefinitions, all I did was overriding because, as I said, this is a virtual method and this is a virtual method too. But I didn't say anything at the beginning it's a virtual, so I will talk about it. In Java, all the methods are virtual by default, okay? In Java, all the methods are virtual by default. If you don't want them to be virtual, you do some other stuff, okay? So basically, all the and potentially, if you are using the base superclasses references to make method calls, okay, basically all the method calls are potentially late bound. Okay, we will talk about it in a few minutes. Okay, so let's see a test, base plus commission employee test. This is my base plus commission employee reference and object. And this is my base salary. And as you see, even though I did not define get first name, get last name inside this base plus commission employee class, okay, I have get first names, get last names, etc., everything, and get base salary. Everything works, okay? And set base salary, get base salary works too. And at the end, I have printf. It says percent %s and percent %s. This one is percent %s. Originally, it used to be two string here, but I don't have to write two string, right? You just do it this way, okay? Just put employee. Oh, by the way, okay, yeah. When I say employee, but what is the type of employee? Employee is this one. Oh, okay. Question. Type of employee is base plus commission employee, right? If I have a commission employee reference, commission employee 3, let's say commission employee, can I make this assignment? Employee is of type commission, base plus commission employee, right? This says base plus commission employee, but this is just a commission employee. Can I make this assignment? Okay, commission employee, base plus commission employee. This is the hierarchy. Okay, can I make this assignment? There is a relationship between them. All the base plus commission employee references are actually commission employee references. So this is just simple upcasting, right? Upcasting is okay. I can do that. No problem. Okay. How about this? Instead of writing employee here, can I say CE, commission employee? The answer is yes, I could, but would I get the same effect as this one?
No. Wouldn't there be some information loss?
It's like a slicing problem, kind of. Any other guesses? What is CE? Okay, CE is a reference to the superclass. And I am calling CE.toString. It depends on the type of toString. If toString is a virtual method, then this is a polymorphic call, right? And I said, in Java, everything is by default virtual. Okay. ToString, clone, whatever function I have defined, set name, get name, etc. They are all virtual. They are all virtual methods. Okay. So in this case, this will do the right thing. So there is a polymorphic call happening in here. Okay. This will be decided during the runtime. So Java people, most of the Java programmers, they don't realize that many things are happening with these kind of calls during the runtime. But as C++ programmers, that's the philosophy of the difference between the philosophies of these two languages. One of them makes the virtual. You need to specifically say that whatever you are doing is virtual, because it is expensive, you are careful about it. The other one doesn't say anything about it. By default, everything is virtual. By default, everything is expensive. If you don't want them to be virtual, then you need to say something else. You need to say something else. Okay? That whatever that thing is, it's going to come, not today, but maybe on Friday. Okay, any questions? We will continue talking about inheritance in Java. We will do this. We will remember the example that I showed you before. Yeah, we will implement this complete hierarchy: employee, commission, base plus commission. But the employee classes is going to be an abstract class. We will see how the abstract classes work. Okay, and we will form this hierarchy. And at the end, we will talk about upcasting and downcasting in Java on Friday. Okay, before coming to the class on Friday, try to implement this yourself. Okay, try to implement this yourself. Now you know the inheritance. Maybe you could do, as an exercise, maybe you could do homework number 5, right, in Java. Do homework number 5 in Java before coming to class on Friday. Okay? I'll see you on Friday. Where is my attendance? Attendance sheet. Where is the attendance sheet?